In a previous video, we talked about what a function is. And we think of a function as a machine. In general, a function takes in an x value, does something to it, and spits out a y value that we call f of x. A somewhat bizarre example would be a machine that takes in someone's DNA and spits out their social security number. Now, in this video, we're going to talk about what the inverse of a function like this looks like. If our function is named f of x, our inverse function is named f inverse of x. And an inverse function takes a y value, or an f of x value, and spits out the x value. It does just the opposite, or the inverse, of what this original function does. So if we look at this somewhat bizarre example, this inverse function would input a social security number and output a person's DNA. Now here's just a little bit of notation for you. If we're plugging an x value into a function, which we call f, we plug that x value in right here and we get out what we call f of x. If we take this f of x then and plug it into our inverse function, we would plug that in right here. And notation wise, that would give us f inverse of f of x. We're plugging that f of x into the inverse function. And what do we get out? Well, we already said that we get out what we started with. We started with x, so that right there notationally is a true statement. If we plug a function value into an inverse function, we get out the original x value that we plugged in the first place. Now we are going to talk more about this notation in class, and we're going to be working with this. Just note that you can reverse these functions as well, and you'll also get the original x value back. So I just wanted you to see that notation before class. Okay, let's talk more about functions and inverse functions. Say instead we have this function, and you input DNA into the function, and the function spits out your eye color. And as we discussed in that previous video about functions, this does qualify as a function because for every one input, you get exactly one output. For every person's DNA you put in, presumably you only get one eye color. So I guess I need to point out that we're going with the assumption that every person has exactly one eye color. Well, okay, if this is your function, what would the inverse function look like? Well, in theory, this inverse function would take an eye color and it would be able to spit out a person's DNA. The problem is this wouldn't really be possible. There are lots of different DNA codes that would give you, say, brown eyes. So if you just plug in brown eyes into this function, the function wouldn't know what to spit out. So this isn't possible. So an inverse of this original function wouldn't exist. Well, didn't we just say above that we had an inverse function that could exist? Yeah, we did. We said that if a function plugs in DNA and spits out social security number, that's a very specific number, then its inverse would take a person's social security number and spit out what their DNA is. This was only possible up here because in this original function, for every one input, there is exactly one output, and for every output, there was exactly one possible input. Notice in this example, for every one input, there is one output, but for every one output, there would be many possible inputs. So I see a definition coming. We are going to define a one-to-one function as a function, meaning for every one input, there's exactly one output, but there's an additional requirement that for each output, there could only be one possible input. We call that a one-to-one function. And the reason we define this one-to-one function is because now we can say that a function can only have an inverse if it is one-to-one. Okay, let's try to look at this concept of an inverse from more of an algebra perspective. We said that a function takes in an x value and spits out a y value. Then the inverse of that same function would take that same y value and spit out an x value. The relationship between a function and its inverse is that our x values and our y values are switched. So if I want to make up a function right here, I'll call it f, and I'll say it has the point 2, 0 on it, and say the point 3, 2 on it. Then the inverse of that function would just have the x and y values switched. So instead of the point 2, 0, you'd have the point 0, 2. And instead of the point 3, 2, you'd have the point 2, 3. And the graph of this inverse function would look something like this. So to get a graph of f inverse, we just switch the x and y values of f. And if we look at that sort of graphically, what that actually does is that reflects our f graph over this line y equals x. You'll notice the symmetry in this picture. So in other words, f inverse is f reflected over the line y equals x if we're looking at a graph. Okay, so this is all really good information. One more type of question that I want to talk about is what if you're asked to find the inverse of a simple function. We'll do more complicated functions in class, but for now, I'll just take you through the process. The first step is we're just going to replace the function with y. Then, to actually take the inverse of this thing, we're going to switch x and y, because that's what an inverse is. Then we're going to solve for y. Solving for y in this example means adding 2 to both sides. It means dividing by 3. And I like, since this is a line here, I like my lines in slope-intercept form. And then we're finished, we found our inverse here, we just need to use the appropriate notation. So we replace our y with f inverse of x. Now it doesn't matter what function I give you, these are the 4 steps for finding the inverse of that function. The algebra might get a little bit harder, depending on the function I give you, but we'll do some more of those in class. I will see you there.